Thank you very much, David. That was an excellent presentation. I'd now like to introduce you to Andrey Kortunov. He's the Director General of the Russian International Affairs Council and the President of the New Eurasia Foundation. Mr. Kortunov graduated from the Moscow State University of International Relations and pursued postgraduate studies at the Institute for the US and Canadian Studies, where he later served as the Deputy Director and Head of the Foreign Policy Department. He was a visiting professor at American universities, including the University of California and the University of Miami. Andrey is an author of more than 120 publications focused on US-Soviet-Russian relations, international security issues, and Soviet-Russian domestic and foreign policy. Andrey Kortunov.
Thank you, Azriel. First of all, let me say that I'm really grateful and I'm honored to be here and to participate in this very timely and very important event. At the same time, I'm a little bit confused because I'm supposed to talk about the US-Russian efforts in the nuclear fields, which means that I have to discuss a subject which is almost non-existent. It's not often that I have such a challenge in front of me. So basically, let me try to focus just on two issues because my time is limited. And in Russia, we usually ask two, I would say, typical questions. The first one is, who is to blame? And the second one is, what is to be done? So let me try to combine the two and ask myself a question, what is to be done by those who are to blame? Because indeed, at least in Russia, we don't see any immediate prospects for the leadership change. Therefore, I think it's important to figure out what the current leadership we have is likely to do within the next couple of years. And let me start with saying that 5 years ago, the New START agreement was signed between Russia and the United States. And I think that this agreement shows both the opportunities and the limitations of the traditional approach to nuclear arms control. On the one hand, this agreement demonstrated that when you have political will, all the problems notwithstanding, you can achieve remarkable results. The whole process took less than a year. I think it lasted for 8 or 9 months only. Many were saying at that point that the strategic culture had been lost on both sides. And that it would take much more time and effort to restore this strategic culture. However, it turned out to be possible to prepare a rather decent treaty. A lot of political pressure was exercised from the very top. I had a chance to talk to the then U.S. Ambassador to Russia, Mike McFaul, who told me when he became ambassador in Moscow that the treaty became possible due to personal engagement of the two presidents, that both of them really tried hard and were engaged in very specific issues. So that was the good news. The bad news, at least for me, was that the treaty did not deviate from the old logic of the Cold War. In a way, you can argue that something like that could have been signed by Nixon and Brezhnev. Because if you look into the negotiation process, if you look into the arguments of the two sides, they implied the same old traditional strategic thinking. The sides were talking about mutual assured deterrence, mutual assured destruction, sorry, about deterrence, about unacceptable damage, about second strike capabilities. So all the vocabulary developed somewhere in early mid-1960s was there. So it was not a breakthrough. And of course, even some proponents of the New START treatment argued that it would be very difficult to go lower within the same logic. In order to go lower, in order to get down to radical cuts, one should have to change the whole logic, the whole thinking on the both sides. And as we know, it never happened. So in a sense, the New START agreement was the last treaty that could have been signed within the paradigm that emerged 50 or maybe even 60 years ago. What did we have after the START agreement? I think that there were two opportunities. Two opportunities that could help us to get away from the old logic. First of all, back in 2010, 2011, we had a rather dynamic Russian-American consultations. One can even argue negotiations on BMD issues. Again, you know, I had a privilege, thank you, I had a privilege of talking to both negotiators. On the US side, it was Alain Tauscher, and on the Russian side, it was Sergei Repkov, Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs. Both Alain and Sergei argued that there was a chance to get to a compromise on BMD, especially in summer of 2011. However, it didn't work for a variety of reasons. It didn't work because of the elections in the United States. It didn't work because Putin came back to power in 2012. But the BMD compromise based on the rejection of the fourth stage of the European deployment was not a breakthrough either, because this compromise did not foresee a joint missile defense effort between Russia and the United States. The whole idea was to prove to Russians that US efforts did not inflate the Russian deterrent potential. Not a big deal. From this viewpoint, this compromise wouldn't be that different from the ABM Treaty of 1972. There was another opportunity, which was also lost. A little bit later, I refer to the Russian-American effort to handle the problem of chemical weapons in Syria. And at that point, when it turned out to be realistic, many people, at least in Moscow, thought that maybe we can apply the same principle of cooperation to nuclear weapons. And maybe we can overcome the inertia of the old thinking and to get down to a more innovative approach to nuclear arms control and nuclear disarmament at large. However, as we know, the Russian-American cooperation on chemical weapons in Syria did not produce a lasting impact and did not help the two sides to overcome their differences in the nuclear field. So this chance was lost, and as we know, after Ukraine, the Russian-American cooperation in the nuclear field was frozen. So what do we have right now? We have the New START agreement. And I think that no side is likely to violate the New START agreement simply because the provisions of this agreement are already factored in the modernization programs of both Russia and the United States. So there is no need to violate the START agreement for either side. We have IMF treaty, and its future is more questionable. There are many people in Russia who believe that under the current political circumstances, IMF does not serve Russia's interests, and it would be better for Russia to withdraw from the treaty. There are accusations made by Russian military that the United States is eroding the provisions of this treaty. The United States has its own list of complaints about how Russia follow the spirit of the treaty. So I wouldn't bet on this treaty to survive for a long period of time. Of course, Russia and the United States are engaged in multilateral negotiations on the Iranian nuclear problem, on North Korea, and this this cooperation is likely to last. However, unlike President Obama, President Putin never believed, at least in my view, in anything like a complete nuclear disarmament. Moreover, he has always had a kind of special attraction to nuclear weapons because, in his view, nuclear weapons were one of the key factors that allowed Russia to maintain its great power status. I can share with you a personal story. When Putin had his election campaign, I was invited with a very small group of experts to talk to him in a closed Russian military city where they produce nuclear warheads, the city of Sarov near Nizhny Novgorod. And there were just, you know, 15 people in the room, and President came, and candidate Putin came, and we had a long discussion about the Russian defense posture. And basically, he focused mostly on the nuclear issues. He demonstrated a lot of knowledge of technical details. He spoke for a very long period of time about why we need the nuclear weapons, why the nuclear weapons constitute the foundation of our defense potential, and he really demonstrated that he is personally engaged and he likes the subject. So I think that it has always been the case. And of course, Ukraine, the Ukrainian crisis, has strengthened these positions of the Russian leadership. When you talk to people in the Kremlin and talk about the correlation between the nuclear posture of Russia and the Ukraine crisis, the standard observation is that the only reason why NATO does not get involved in Ukraine directly in a military way, because we have nuclear weapons. That's why they cannot afford to start a conflict that might escalate to a nuclear conflict with the Russian Federation. So that means that Russia should stick to its weapons and should continue its modernization efforts no matter what. So this is the position. And if you look at the current budget crunch, which starts to affect the Russian defense budget as well, and if you see the discussions that are going on in the Russian Federation about what we can cut if we are forced to cut. They talk about Navy quite often, that probably we should make some adjustments in terms of the Navy modernization programs. They talk sometimes about the Air Force, but there are two sacred cows in the Russian defense planning. The first one is a rapid deployment, conventional force, and after Ukraine that has become even more important. We need to have this rapid deployment just in case something happens in Central Asia or elsewhere, and we'll have to employ them. And the second sacred cow is, of course, the nuclear arsenal. And Putin just recently proudly stated that the progress in the nuclear modernization goes along schedule, and that no sanctions are going to slow down the Russian defense effort. So this is, of course, something which is not that different from the NATO posture during the Cold War, when NATO felt that they are inferior to the Warsaw Pact in terms of conventional weapons. They had to rely on the nuclear arsenal and even on the first nuclear strike strategy. Right now we see that the Russian military plan assumes that Russia might be the first to nuke nuclear weapons if its vital interests are threatened. So what about the future? I have the luxury to talk about a longer term future because Putin is likely to stay long in power than the US president, though we never know what happens, of course. But I think that the nuclear arms control in the form we used to know it is becoming history. It's very unlikely that anything like that is going to happen anytime soon. And I think that if we are talking about priorities of what I would call nuclear management rather than nuclear arms control in years to come, I think that this nuclear management will have a number of specific features. First of all, it's likely that it will be not just bilateral, but multilateral, with some other nuclear powers engaged. We don't know how to engage them. We don't really know what multilateral deterrence might mean, how we can calculate all these arsenals. But definitely, it's important to make sure that this business does not stay as a bilateral U.S.-Russian business. Second, I think that definitely for nuclear powers, the most important challenge will be non-state actors, which might get hold of nuclear weapons. So I can assume that all the differences, all the disagreements, all the conflicts between Russia and the West notwithstanding, efforts in preventing irresponsible non-state actors from acquiring nuclear weapons will continue. So that might include safety of stockpiles, that might include exchange of information, things like that. I also believe that Russia, and probably not only Russia and China, some other countries, might focus their attention on trying to block the most destabilizing avenues of nuclear arms race. And again, if you go to Moscow, if you go to the Russian general staff, of course they're concerned about a technological gap. They're concerned specifically about, for example, high-precision conventional weapons that the United States might deploy, and these weapons might be used as first-strike weapons to disarm Russia in terms of its nuclear arsenal. So I think that there'll be attempts to identify the most important, the most dangerous avenues of nuclear and conventional arms race and to block them to the extent possible. I also believe that there'll be attempts to get some kind of more stability and predictability in the military nuclear posture of major players. Definitely no one is interested in accidental launches or inadvertent escalation given the current political environment. These tasks remain very important. As far as more ambitious goals in nuclear disarmament, I'm not sure that these goals are realistic within the next couple of years. Because in order to pursue these goals, you need to have a common vision of the future of the international system. You need to have trust with all the verification procedures. Really, you need to have more trust to go away, to go beyond the traditional deterrence posture. And this trust is simply not there. And finally, you know, let me just say a few words about the Iranian issue. I agree mostly with what David said. I would add that in my view, for Iran, if they were to choose between where to make additional concessions, the preservation of the infrastructure is a top priority. They can agree to verifications, they can make concessions on other issues, but I think that it would be difficult to imagine some, you know, new steps in terms of destroying the infrastructure that has already been developed by Iran. Second, I know here I agree fully that the issue of sanctions is very important because I had the chance to receive many Iranian diplomats in Moscow. My impression is that the positions of Rouhani are not really strong right now, and unless he can deliver on sanctions as fast as possible, and unless, you know, these sanctions include some sanctions which are not directly related to the nuclear program, I think it would be difficult for him to sell it to his constituency. And finally, I think that when we talk about Iran, and maybe it sounds trivial, but I would like nevertheless to emphasize it, there is a huge difference between Iran and North Korea. North Korea has nothing to offer the world except for nuclear weapons. Iran has a lot. So I think that for Iran, the issue of a nuclear program is and will be linked to its positions in the region. If Iran is recognized implicitly or explicitly as a great power in this whole region, if there is a compromise on other issues, including Syria and maybe some other, I think if Iran gets more confidence, it would be easier for the leadership to demonstrate more moderation in its nuclear efforts. If, however, you know, we see a major split between Iran and the Arab states, if we see disagreements between Tehran and Washington on most serious regional issues, I'm afraid that the nuclear deal might be less important than otherwise. Thank you.